each piece or the groups of pieces before I play them. But before I start, it's lovely to be here, and it's terrifying to play for students, because I have spent the week telling them, now you must do this and you must do that, and under no circumstances should you do X. And then if I play and they say, you said you weren't supposed to do that, then all my credibility goes out the window. As Vida said, I'm going to play a program of works, most of which are incredibly beautiful, I feel, but completely unknown. So I'd better start with something that's very familiar. I'm going to start with two nocturnes by Chopin. The first nocturne is the E-flat major, opus 9, number 2. It's perhaps the most famous piece that he wrote, but I'm going to play the Eckier edition. And Jan Eckier was the head of the Chopin Academy in Warsaw. He was a musicologist as well as a great teacher and performer. And when Chopin lived in Paris, he taught all these famous, rich Polish countesses. And he would write out the music for them, and they would play it, and then they would go back to their castles in Poland, and they would put it in the library, eventually, of the castle. And Jan Eckier went to the libraries of the castles in Poland, and he examined all the handwritten by Chopin editions of this nocturne. And what he found is that Chopin didn't write the same music for each student. It's as if this student can do trills really well. I'll put a bunch of trills in for them. This student can barely play at all. I'll do one or two notes and that's all they get. And what Jan Eckier did in his edition of the nocturnes is he puts two versions. The first is the first published version, which is the version we all know. And the second has variants, like four or five choices. So some of us are old enough to remember pick and mix in Woolworths. So it's kind of like that, that you say, I'll do this, I won't do that one, but I'll do this, I'll do this. So every note that I'm going to play is written by Chopin, but some of them will be new to you, I hope. The second nocturne is the D flat major. It really needs very, very little introduction. Supposedly Chopin was at a dinner player with a violinist, and they were arguing about which has the better instrument. And the violinist said, we can do beautiful, beautiful melodies. And Chopin said, we can do beautiful, beautiful melodies too, but we can also do double stopping. And our double stops are in tune.
Thank you.
We're staying with Chopin for this, one of the last pieces that he wrote. It's the Barcarolle, and a Barcarolle is an ocean-going ship or a piece to do with the sea. And traditionally, this is thought of as a Venetian gondola ride. You can hear it's got a lilting three rhythm that's supposed to be waves underneath the gondola. There is one passage that is famous where a repeated F sharp towards the end, there's a repeated F sharp, and he plays it over and over and over again while the harmony above it changes and goes farther and farther and farther away from F sharp until you are ended with this chord, which is quite extraordinary for a piece that was written in the middle of the 19th century. There is what is supposed to be a Venetian gondola song halfway through, but Chopin composed it himself, and he said that this was one of the most difficult things, to write this seemingly simple Italian folk song. Ravel was fascinated by the idea that you could have a repeated note all the way through, well, through a large part of the Barcarolle. And in his most famous piano, big piano composition called Gaspard de la Nuit, he has going through the entire piece. And that is, in Gaspard de la Nuit, supposed to represent a body of a hanged man being blown by the wind against a scaffold in an incredibly grisly piece. But there is nothing grisly about our charming Italian boat ride. This is the Barcarolle of Chopin.
Thank you.
second half of his life in Paris. And we're going to stay in Paris and jump forward 100 years to the music of two sisters. The sisters are Lily and Nadia Boulanger. Their mother was a Russian princess. Their father was a music teacher and a musician and a composer, and he was on the faculty of the Paris Conservatoire. He was considerably older than his wife, and when Lily was born, he was 75. Lily was the younger sister, but she was probably the more precocious and perhaps the more talented. Unfortunately, she died at the age of 24. She had intestinal tuberculosis, but perhaps Crohn's disease. Anyway, it was extraordinarily sad. She won the Prix de Rome, which is the big prize that is given to composition students, one composition student every year, to go and study in Rome in a villa owned by the Paris Conservatoire. And she was the first woman to win it, and she won it something like 70 years after her father had won it. Her sister Nadia lived a very long life. She lived, I think, 84 years. And she was incredibly famous, not so much as a composer herself, but as perhaps the preeminent teacher of composers and composition students in the middle of the 20th century. Virgil Thompson said she especially loved Americans because they were rich. And Virgil Thompson said that every small town in America has two things: a five and dime store, and a student of Nadia Boulanger. I'm going to play two pieces, Prelude in D-flat by Lily, and Vers la vie nouvelle by Nadia. The Prelude in D-flat, it's on IMSLP, and she didn't publish it in her lifetime, and so you can look at the score that she wrote, and it's incredibly difficult to make out her hand. So I hope that I'm going to play the prelude that she intended. The Vers la vie nouvelle was written just after the First World War. And I like to think of it that you hear the First World War. And then there's a distant trumpet, and it calls the bodies of the dead soldiers, the souls of the dead soldiers, to wake up and to go towards a new life. So two pieces, both basically preludes by the Boulanger sisters.
Thank you.
pianist to have four arms and need to range over the keyboard, and they're not afraid of big sounds. And even though it, one of the strange things, I play a lot of music by written by women. You would think that music written by women would be forgiving of small hands, and that there would be a lot of music that was beautifully written for little hands. But it's almost as if they wanted to prove that they could write man music. And so both Boulanger's and Clara Schumann and just about everybody, they all write for huge, huge hands, even though you would think they would be the most sympathetic to people with small hands. Fortunately, I have massive mitts, so we're just fine. Staying with music by a woman, but moving to North America, this is a piece called Troubled Water by the African-American composer Margaret Barnes. And it's based on the spiritual Wade in the Water. And Wade in the Water, in Cincinnati, there's the Museum of the Underground Railroad. And if you're ever in Cincinnati, you should visit it. And in that museum, there's a section about the songs and the spirituals of African Americans who were enslaved. And it turns out that the spiritual wade in the water has great significance, because if you wade in water as you are trying to escape from dogs, your scent is taken away and they cannot find you. And so it's one of the keys, or one of the paths, or one of the techniques that you use to obtain freedom. So it's desperately important and significant. She wrote it in a time of great trouble during the civil rights movement of the 1960s, and I thought it was appropriate to play it now. So this is Margaret Bond's Troubled Water.
Thank you.
Lily Boulanger. These are three pieces. The first one is in an old garden, and it really illustrates her incredible sense of harmony. She uses the most wonderful chords. Then Jardin Clair in a bright garden. It's very strange, this piece, because it starts out quickly and it gets slower and slower and slower, which is most unusual. Usually pieces start slow and they build. I think this is, it mimics the effect of a beautiful garden, because we're all running around in our day-to-day lives, and then we go to a garden and we sit there and it works its magic and we calm down. And in this case, we calm down for a parade. Cortège is a parade or a procession. And I think this parade gets rained out, because towards the end, suddenly we go faster and faster and faster as you see them scrambling to end the parade before the downpour begins. So, three pieces by Lily Boulanger.
Thank you.
Tanet was a French cabaret singer. He wrote his own songs most of the time. Beyond the Sea, which was an American hit in the 1950s, is one of his. I'm going to play Alexis Weissenberg's arrangement of three of his songs. Alexis Weissenberg, a very famous classical pianist, he loved to mess around. And so he arranged these, and he recorded them. But he was afraid that if he recorded them under the name Alexis Weissenberg, everybody would think, oh, that Weissenberg, he's not a serious pianist. Let's never hire him again. So he recorded them under the name Mr. Nobody. So these are three pieces. Boom is about boom. Suddenly you fall in love, and it's like a bolt out of blue out of the sky. Coin de Rue is the street where I used to grow, where I grew up. And he's looking back at where he grew up. And it's sort of poignant. And the harmonies are very, very strange, which makes you think sort of that it's tinged with melancholy. But perhaps he's really happy that he never went back. And then the final one is Vous oubliez votre cheval. And it's just a nonsense song. It's a little bit like Ain't She Sweet. But what it means is, you forgot your horse, mister. And it's being sung by a hot Czech girl in a nightclub, and she says, hey, you forgot your horse, you can't leave your horse behind. And she says, the horse got bored, so I sang it a song. The horse was hungry, so I fed it some soup. But you left your horse behind, you've got to take it with you. So it makes no sense at all.
Boom.
I thought, seeing as we're in a former synagogue, I thought that it would be appropriate to play music by Irving Shorhoff. Irving Shorhoff was a Czech composer. He was Jewish. He wrote in many different styles, but the one that I liked the most is his jazz-influenced composition. And so I'll play a piece of his called Susie. He published it in the 1930s under an assumed name because his music was banned. He was Jewish, he wasn't allowed to publish anymore. But he did, he kept publishing and publishing because he really wanted, well, he wanted to live, but he wanted his music to get out there. And so this piece was published under the name Emman Baltzar, and then when they found out that Emman Baltzar was Irving Shorhoff, he published under the name John Longfellow, and so on it went on. Of course, this was really risky and very dangerous, and sooner or later it caught up with him. And so he was sent to a concentration camp where he died. But I think this piece, it's just so beautiful because it says, I have something that I have to say, even if it means putting my life in danger. So I thought I would play it today. It's Susie by Irving Shorhoff.